Hi students, you are watching Biology for All and I am your teacher Dr. Mahmood Hassan. Today we will continue with another process of respiration called Krebs cycle that was named after the name of the scientist who discovered this chemical process in 1930. It is also called TCA or tricarboxylic acid cycle because most of the intermediates of this cycle have three carboxyl groups. It is also called citric acid cycle because the first intermediate of this process is citric acid. We will not directly jump onto the topic, and before reaching there, we will briefly discuss about the structure of mitochondrial membranes and various stages of metabolic processes in the living organisms. Before I continue my lecture, please click on the link below to subscribe to my channel Biology for All. If you take a look at the electron micrograph of mitochondria on the top left of the slide, it can be seen that the outer boundary of mitochondria contains two membranes. The outer mitochondrial membrane completely encloses the mitochondria. The inner mitochondrial membrane forms a series of invaginated membrane sheets called cristae. The role of mitochondria as energy transducer is intimately tied to the membranes of the cristae that are so prominent in electron micrographs of these organelles. The cristae contain a large amount of membrane surface, which house the machinery needed for aerobic respiration and ATP formation. The organization of the cristae are shown in a clearer profile in the scanning electron micrograph on the top right of the slide, and the three-dimensional reconstruction of the cross-section of mitochondria in the middle. The membranes of mitochondria divide organelle into two aqueous compartments, one within the interior of the mitochondrion called the matrix, and second between the outer and the inner membranes called intermembrane space. The outer membrane is composed of approximately 50% lipid by weight. In contrast, the inner membrane contains more than 100 different polypeptides and has a very high protein to lipid ratio. The inner membrane is virtually devoid of cholesterol and rich in an unusual phospholipid, which are characteristic of bacterial plasma membrane from which the inner mitochondrial membrane has presumably evolved. The outer mitochondrial membrane is thought to be homologous to an outer membrane present as a part of the cell wall of certain bacterial cells. The outer mitochondrial membrane and the outer bacterial membrane both contain porins, which is an integral protein that have a relatively high internal channels surrounded by the barrel of strands. The porins of the outer mitochondrial membrane are not static structures as was once thought, but can undergo reversible closure in response to conditions within the cell. When the porin channels are wide open, the outer membrane is freely permeable to molecules such as ATP and NAD and coenzyme A, which have a key role to play in energy metabolism within mitochondria. In contrast, the inner mitochondrial membrane is highly impermeable, and virtually all molecules and ions require special membrane transporters to gain entrance into the matrix. The composition and organization of the inner mitochondrial membrane are the keys to bioenergetic activities of the organelles. The architecture of the inner membrane and apparently fluidity of its bilayer facilitate the interactions of components that are required for ATP formation. Metabolic pathways of the cell can be divided into two broad types. Catabolic pathways lead to disassembly of the complex molecules to form simpler products. Catabolic pathways serve two functions. They make available the raw materials from which other molecules can be synthesized, and they provide chemical energy required for many activities of the cell. As we will discuss at length, energy released by catabolic pathways is stored temporarily in two forms, as high energy phosphate molecules called ATP and as high energy electrons, primarily NADH. Anabolic pathways lead to the synthesis of more complex compounds from simple starting material. Anabolic pathways are energy requiring and utilize chemical energy released by exergonic catabolic pathways. Figure in the bottom shows a greatly simplified profile of the ways in which the major anabolic and catabolic processes are interconnected. Macromolecules are first disassembled or hydrolyzed into the building blocks of which they are made, as shown in stage 1. Once macromolecules have been hydrolyzed into their components, amino acids, sugars, and fatty acids, the cell can reutilize the building blocks directly to form other macromolecules of the same class. Stage 1 and 2 convert them into different compounds to make the other products, or number 3, degrade them further, as shown in stage 2 and stage 3, and extract a measure of their free energy content. The pathways for degradation of the diverse building blocks of macromolecules vary according to the type of the compound being catabolized. Ultimately, however, all these molecules are converted into small variety of the compounds that can be metabolized similarly. Thus, even though substances begin as macromolecules having a very different structure, they are converted by catabolic pathways to the same low molecular weight metabolites. For example, catabolic pathways are said to be convergent. Remarkably, the chemical reactions and metabolic pathways described are found in virtually every living cell. Krebs cycle, TCA cycle, or citric acid cycle holds a central position in all catabolic reactions in all living organisms, from the simplest bacterium to the most complex plants or animals. It is evident that these pathways appeared very early in and have been retained through the course of biological evolution. We described the initial stages in the oxidation of carbohydrates in our last video. Beginning with the glucose, the first steps of oxidation process are carried out by the enzymes of glycolysis, which are present in cytosol. The 10 reactions that constitute the glycolytic pathway were also illustrated in the last video. Only a small fraction of free energy available in glucose is made available to the cells during glycolysis, enough for the net synthesis of only 2 molecules of ATP per molecule of glucose oxidized. Most of the energy remains stored in pyruvate. Each molecule of NADH produced during oxidation of glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate also carries a pair of high energy electrons. The 2 products of glycolysis, pyruvate and NADH, can be metabolized into 2 very different ways depending on the type of the cell in which they are formed and the presence or absence of oxygen. In the presence of oxygen, aerobic organisms are able to extract large amounts of additional energy from the pyruvate and NADH produced during glycolysis, enough to synthesize more than 30 additional ATP molecules. Each pyruvate molecule produced by glycolysis is transported across the inner mitochondrial membrane and into the matrix, where it is decarboxylated to form a 2-carbon acetyl group. The acetyl group is transferred to coenzyme A to produce acetyl-CoA. Prior to entering Krebs cycle, pyruvic acid molecules are altered. Each 3-carbon pyruvic acid molecule undergoes conversion to a substance called acetyl coenzyme A. During this process, pyruvic acid molecule is broken down to release 1 carbon dioxide, and the remaining 2 carbon atoms are combined with coenzyme A to form acetyl-CoA. In this process, electrons and hydrogen ions are transferred to NAD to form high-energy NADH. The citrate molecule so formed is highly stable, so the iconitase enzyme links to the citrate to move one of its oxygen atoms to create a more unstable citrate isomer. It does this by extracting a water molecule, producing cis iconitate, and then reattaching the water to form isocitrate. The third step is catalyzed by isocitrate dehydrogenase. With the citrate rearranged, the process begins. Citrate dehydrogenase links to isocitrate, which transforms an electron to the NAD, nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide, producing its energized form NADH. With the electron removed, the enzyme then detaches a carbon atom to form a molecule of carbon dioxide. This transforms the substance to form a 6-carbon molecule to a 5-carbon molecule. Step 4 involves a highly developed complex of 24 enzymes labeled as alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase. This complex transfers also electrons to NAD producing NADH, removes another carbon atom as carbon dioxide to form a 5-carbon to a 4-carbon molecule and relinks the coenzyme A to the substrate. The fifth step is catalyzed by succinyl-CoA synthetase. This step directly produces ATP because the substrate's link to coenzyme A is sufficiently energetic to power the reaction. In mitochondria, the enzyme links to the succinyl-CoA and uses energy from releasing the coenzyme to add phosphate to GDP to produce GTP. In the cytoplasm, a variation on this enzyme can produce ATP directly. This also begins the manipulation of the substrate to reproduce its original form. The sixth step is catalyzed by succinate dehydrogenase. With the carbons removed, the rearrangement process begins manipulating the hydrogen. When the succinate dehydrogenase links to the substrate, it releases 2 hydrogen atoms, attaching them to the carrier ubiquitone or FAT flavin adenine dinucleotide. With the additional 2 electrons formed, which is then transferred to the power of the electron transport chain. Step 7 is catalyzed by fumarase. Fumarase contains the rearrangement process by adding hydrogen and oxygen back into the substrate that had been previously removed. Step 8 is catalyzed by malate dehydrogenase. Finally, the malate dehydrogenase recreates oxaloacetate substrate and moves electrons from NAD to form NADH. This is all for today. Thank you very much for listening to the lecture. See you in the next lecture. Bye for now.